the crowd is going along with it, I'm going to do what? Wink my eye. Give it a wink. Don't rock the boat. Verse 10, verse 11, the mouth of a righteous man is a well of life, but violence covers the mouth of the wicked.
Proverbs 1.
Wow, I still want to go to 10. 1 and 2. Okay, all right, that makes a lot of sense. I don't know why, maybe I should have been in 10. If centers entice me, do what?
Don't go with it.
The crowd said, let's do this. Back in my day, let's go steal some of those peaches off that tree across the fence on the way home from the ballpark. They didn't give it a second thought. Yeah. Pockets full of peaches on the way home. Robin Hood was fruit trees.
Nobody else did nothing like that. I was the only one.
Yeah, you were.
Yeah.
No.
We see some nice fruit hanging off the tree on our way home from the baseball field from practice. Hot. Eat something to eat. That's lunch right there. Wild Millions.
Yeah.
Cherries, pears.
It's done.
Apple tree.
Yeah. It's done. Yeah. The grocery store open on the way between home and practice, wherever I was.
It's closed.
I didn't get caught. Case closed. Mm-hmm. Have no love of Jesus in my heart. So what morals should have kept you from doing that? No, morals are weak. Moral standards are weak. The right pressure, the right influence will make you do something what the crowd is saying. That's why you need the spirit in you to strong enough against it. Morals won't get you nowhere with God. Oops.
And don't stand up against Satan either.
Don't stand up against Satan either. Here we go. You go to the happy hour enough times with the crowd, you'd be pretty soon you'd be happy. Go happy. I don't know if we're going to get through this lesson. We got to go through Proverbs 1 through 19. So somebody read that.
My son, if sinners entice thee, consent thou not. Amen. If they say, come with us, let us lay weights of blood. Let us look privily for the innocent without cause. Let us swallow them up alive as the grave, and whole as those that go down into the pit. We shall find all precious subjects. We shall fill our houses with spoil. Cast in thy lot among us. Let us all have one purse. My son, walk not thou in the way with them. Refrain thy foot from their path. For their feet run to evil and make haste to shed blood. Surely in vain the net is spread in the sight of any bird. And they lay wait for their own blood. They lurk privily for their own lives. So are the ways of every one that is greedy of gain, which taketh away the life of the owners thereof.
Right. And that's especially verse 14. Cast in thy lot with us. Let us have how many purses?
One
purse. Vote this way. Vote this way. What's the name of the tribe trying to get the casino in Brocadero?
Calamity
or something.
Calamity.
Yeah, whatever it is, trying to get the casino. The mayor says, I don't know about.
Come to find out, really, you didn't more than what you were saying.
Guess what? You're no longer mayor. But casting that lot, make your vote so that you can get some of those proceeds, some of that money. Yeah, a little bit. So politics can get you if the crowd is there. If all you got to stand on is your moral standards, the purse is big enough, you fall in. Ask Judas. Okay. Let's ask Judas. So how do I condition myself against that? That's in Romans 12, 1 through 2. We read it all the time. How do I toughen myself up? How do I toughen myself up? Someone read that, if you will, please.
Romans 12.
1 through 2.
I beseech
you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God.
Amen. I'm reminded of Zacchaeus, I believe, when Jesus called him down out of that tree. Zacchaeus, he said, Lord, everything, I'm going to give you half of my stuff. I'm giving half of it to the poor. Conviction came over him. Yeah. He got converted. He said, you know, I've been wrong. Half of my stuff I got in my, you know, I've been cheating, but I'm going to give half of it because he knew that he had been doing wrong after he had got a heart change. And here, how do you not be not conformed to this world? By the renewing, how you say it? Of your mind. How can you prove what's the good thing, the best thing to do? Because politics, community, the church, anybody, any entity can influence you to make the wrong deal if the purse is big enough. And you'll think, the purse is big enough for me, all right. Whoa, let's talk about this. That's what politics is all about, following the crowd, following the biggest purse. Verse 3 of our lesson is going to talk about how to treat people in different social classes. We call it low income or something like that, middle income, high income, all these different classes of people that we're dealing with today in society. But there's a group of people that's easily to be identified, and those are the ones on the low economic end of the pole. Yeah. How do we deal with them? Because if I, here's the balance. If a poor person goes to trial, and I use this in all my professional presentations to employers. If a poor person goes to trial, here's his chances concerning what's written on the west side, I believe, of the Supreme Court. Equal justice under law is the reality. It ain't true. Justice has got one color to it. And when you run out of you have ran out of justice.
Very true.
And if you don't believe me, give it a try.
Yeah, you're right.
So if the poor is mistreated by someone, then the poor, he has no recourse. If the rich is mistreated, this recourse is I can persuade others to don't do business with you. I can get you all the place because I got influence and money all over the place. But if the poor is completely guilty and he walks into a courtroom, how should the judge behave himself? Should I lean toward the poor guy because he's weaker than all this stuff over here and over there? Or, you know, should I give him a little fair chance, give him a little favorability in my rulings, or should I just go straight down the middle?
Yes.
Dealing with the poor. You know, so how does God does that? So let's see here. The social class. Neither shall thy countenance a poor man and his what? Cause. No, don't give him no favor. Ooh. Williams show up in court, straight down the middle. But you know, maybe he was just too poor to do whatever. Straight down. I'm saying, I got compassion. I got a heart for the poor.
He's just trying to feed his kids now.
Poor man. Got to feed his family. So you catch him stealing groceries out of the grocery store. It's in his pocket. Do you prosecute him or do you let him slide? Question to the court. Anybody got any objections?
Prosecutor, they give him probation.
Poor man riding to work, poor lady riding to work, she don't have a tag up to date. Should a cop pull her over or let her go?
Let her go.
You were warning.
Question to the class. Pull over, let it go.
Pull over, let it go.
Brother Williams.
Yes, ma'am.
I think my answer would be you should pull him over, but it's in his authority to let her go. You should pull him over. I've been in that situation. One time I was driving to Texas, and hey, I was wrong. I was driving about 80 miles an hour, and the light was flashing. And I thought, it was Thanksgiving Day, and I thought, I am not going to get a ticket Thanksgiving Day. But you know what happened? Then patrolman pulled around me. He pulled the guy in front of me over, but I thought, oh, I'm off. Then he did this.
He brought you
for me
over
to
too,
get off. Okay. So I did. And I waited. We waited a long time, and I thought, what is happening up there? And so what happened was he came back to me and says, young lady, where are you going? I said, I'm going to my sister-in-law. We are going to my sister-in-law's, Pastor Hill and I. I was driving for Thanksgiving. He said, well, you better slow down. He said, I'm not going to give you a ticket today. Praise the Lord. And he said, the reason why I'm not going to give it to you is because the guy ahead of you is a patrolman from Missouri. He was driving a plane car, and he said, he broke the law. He should know better. Oh. I didn't give him a ticket, so I'm not going to give you one.
Oh.
I said, thank you, sir. But he pulled me over. He should have, but he didn't.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. 250 ticket. 150.
He should have pulled over. He should have given her.
Yeah, he should have given me one. Because I was going faster.
According to the law and the paperwork?
Absolutely.
Black and white, she should have got a ticket.
But he had mercy.
There's a reason why that there's a reason why that lady of justice has a blindfold on. Why does she have a blindfold on and scales?
Equality.
The lady of justice.
Yeah. Equal.
She has a blindfold on.
Oh, wow.
And scales in her hands.
Supposed to be equal.
Yep.
It's not
the idea that you don't see any difference in anything.
Weigh in the man. So, if a poor person is, guilty, don't lie and all that, get them off. Woo! My daughter Jessica is the world's worst. Should have known better. I don't know how I raised her. She is down the middle. She don't care who you are. Should have known better. She got her homework done as early as she could. It was 2 weeks out. She got it done by the second day. A friend or someone called her and said, hey, can you help me? Like, oh, I ain't got time to mess with you. You knew that was done. It was due. And here it is the night before, and you want me to run to the high house? No. You want to know why she is where she is today? Because that's how she's been like that from the cradle. That's how she's been. If you don't believe me, try. She's very straight. She married a guy like that, so it takes two to be like that.
Sometimes you have to see the gray areas of it.
Mm-hmm.
And that doesn't mean that seeing the gray areas is necessarily wrong.
Yeah.
I believe you should follow the rules, but sometimes in certain situations there are gray areas. Okay, for instance, Solomon, the women with the babies. We all know the story.
Okay, cut it.
Okay, all right. So wisdom in that. We don't have time to go into that.
He didn't know who was lying, who didn't lie.
Right.
It's like the judge in Edwards' trial. I know he's a liar. I know he's no good.
No.
I don't know what to do. Can't judge it in court of law. But in God's court, there is no what? Gray area. What? No gray area in God's court. Ten Commandments, no gray area. In my heart of hearts.
Okay. If you take it a step further, though, when you're talking about a poor person, let's just say it's a traffic situation, you could open up a domino effect by not stopping them because down the line there should be some complications. A poor person may not have insurance.
Sure.
And then you get into a lot of chains.
Sure. How many brothers used to drink and drive?
I'm just a brother.
16, pull up there, and the guy knew exactly who I was. The name of the club, right down there, was Cincinnati and Pine, just about. I pull up there, 16 years, I'm driving. Can order as many shots as I want. But if I would have left out of there and had an accident, and if you do it today, even at a social party, you overload the guy with alcohol, and he goes committed. And they don't stop a drunk driver, don't give him a ticket, not like that. Or you let him go, he's almost on the road. Back in the day, you could do it, get away with it. Now they don't. Why is that? Because it's too costly. So if you let the guilty go and you fraud it, you fix it up, it's going to be costly. Ten Commandments is cut and dry. God's law, His ways are cut and dry. It ain't no great. You say, well, it's mercy. You're going to let God deal with that mercy stuff. All right, y'all doing it. Four or five more verses to get through. Okay. Verse 3 of our lesson. What's it say? Okay, don't give the poor any favor in his cause. Don't be lenient to the poor when it comes to the law. Give no favor. Don't be favorable to them. Here's one, verse 4. Someone help me out there.
If thou meet thine enemy's ox or his ass going astray, thou shalt surely bring it back to him again.
Now, of course, we was talking about verse 3. Romans 3, 3rd chapter, verse 10 through 12, tells you why. Tells you why. If a person is messing up, that's because the nature is bad. That's all. The nature is bad. And it took the redemptive work of Jesus Christ to bring everybody into favorability with God, whoever would accept that redemptive work. So when you meet somebody that, whether they're rich or poor, doing wrong, it's because of their nature. Okay. But verse 4, if thou meet thy enemy's ox, or his ass going astray. In other words, if you see his livestock outside the gate, lost, just roaming around, but he belongs to your enemy. it's my enemy's pig, his chickens, what have you,
Wallet.
His wallet. Oh, yeah, I got that cold cash in it. Ooh, he probably's going, wow, man, he cheated me a couple of days ago. What they call it, karma? What goes around comes around? I got it. I got it. Let's just, the universe just squaring stuff up. What do you do? Do you take it back to him? Do you keep it? In this case, you like that cow, whatever, you just wander around the pasture of laws and get further laws, further away from home. Or do you take it back to your enemy?
Why would you pay?
Easy to do if you got the love of God in your home. How many went through the ice storm? How many years ago that's been very memorable?
Yeah.
How about, a couple years ago, the snow up about here? Anybody remember that? How many help some unsaved people out in any of those situations?
Yeah.
Trees hanging, lights off, everybody in the cold, dark house. Those are some good times to show the love of God in your heart. Your own personal sacrifice for the welfare of your neighbor. In my case, helping my neighbor cut down tree lines. Because they knocked out all the utility lines and everything. I'm helping out. You got some food, you got this, you got that. The snow, shoveling the snow. This guy never did have said hello to me when I waved at him right across the street when I'm digging him out, helping him out. So there's some times when you and I can show the love of God in our hearts when it's not too much in our best interest. And when I'm going to say best interest, profitable for us to do it at that time. Take some money to the store and all like that. What am I getting out of this? You have to display the love of God in your heart. And this is my enemy. They talk about me because I go to church on it. Talk about me because I don't come over and have a beer with them. Well, verse 5. Someone read that, please.
Verse 5. If thou see the ass of him that hateth thee lying under his burden, and wouldst forbear to help him, thou shalt surely help with him.
You should surely give him help. Now here's what Jesus will say, Matthew 5, 44. Strange things. If you don't have a love of God in your heart, it's hard to do. But I say unto you, love who?
Your enemy.
Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you. And pray for them which despitefully take advantage of you every chance they get. Verse 45, that you may be who?
Children of your Father.
See, ain't none of us like that. See, my enemy messing over me, cheating me out of my money and all this like that. He don't get no rain anymore. Maybe for the whole year. But, but the Heavenly Father makes the rain all over the year. Even his enemies. Wow. That's the only way that you can prove, guarantee without a doubt, that you are a child of God. By how you are governed in life. Many people are governed by, I'm going to get even. Took advantage of me, you frauded, you lied on me, you a Republican, you a Democrat, you conservative. I'm going to show you that we got it better over here on this side of the fence, so I'm going to be using that. Anybody ever been offered the opportunity to bribe? Fraudulent. Say it like this. Show it like this so that we all can benefit. If you don't be an individual and according to Romans 12, 1 and 2, you can be led by the pack mentality. Let's hang them. That's what the packs, let's hang them. Let's put it to them. So, nobody's like that. Yeah, politicians are like that. Politics is a dirty business. It's okay. All right. Romans 5 and 8. What does it say? Child of God. because God died for you. You got to demonstrate.
Wow.
No retaliation. Don't shoot him. Don't cuss him out. Tough. All right. So look at Deuteronomy 22 and 4. I hate to keep running this through the Bible. 22 and 4. Okay. I find my enemy's billfold, as Candy put it, something like that. Do I take it to him? Do I take the cash out of him and take the rest of the stuff out? 22 and 4, what does it say? Thou shalt not see thy brother's ass or his axe fall down by the way, and hide thyself from him. Act like you didn't see it. Mm-hmm. Thou shalt surely help him to lift them up, what? Again, help them out. Help them out. My enemy, help them out. Wow. Is that more effective than saying to someone, meet me at the coffee shop, I'm going to show you how to get saved. Yeah. I will give you the word with all the ABCs on how to get saved, how to get into heaven. Meet me at such and such a time, we're going to talk it over. Or is it more effective to say, he's in trouble, let me go help him out?
Gospel is more effective, but then you're more effective in getting him to listen to the gospel doing it that way than to say, meet me here.
Anybody else? I surveyed the room. which is more effective? The guy has a flat tire on the way to work, your neighbor, he cussed you out the other day. Did something to your shrubbery or something, caused it to die. So, turn your trash can over, his dog's doing it all the time. You meet him on the way to work. On the way to work out one morning, and you help him with his flat, or get his car started, or get him on the way. Is that more effective than saying, let me talk to you about the Lord?
More effective to his conscience. His own conscience. Himself,
then,
as the
thing. I'm going to treat this kind of bad. Somewhere in the scripture says you put coals of fire on. You show him the love of God. When you come back with the love of God, with love, respond back in love. Help him out. Oh, you're almost out of gas, too. Here, here's my $20, which is a piece of gas. See, these little things right here, people don't, they overlook when it comes to winning people to Christ. The love aspect of our walk is the most powerful tool we have in our toolbox.
Also, God seems to give you those opportunities. Sometimes they go by the wayside.
It's an opportunity. Twenty something. Okay, praise God. All right. Here is the burdensome folks of society. Who would that be?
Poor folks.
Over here like that. But who is the burdensome group to society? The poor. How are we going to treat them? And anybody ever have a guy come up to your door with some fruit and say, we got some fruit out of somewhere in Arkansas? Big old grapefruit. Want to sell it to you. Anybody not going to do ever do that?
Yes.
Yeah. Lord, sell it. Yeah. A stranger. Give him time. You buy that stuff.
I bought
something. Meat. 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 Meat.
Meat. Meat. Meat. Meat. Meat. Meat. Meat. Meat. Meat. Meat. Meat. Meat. Meat. Meat. How do I treat the poor? This is also dealing with people who are not like you. Poor. How do you treat poor? We as black folks, how do you treat poor whites? Most of those people come to your door, Sister Hill,
They come where?
They come to your door with that fruit.
Most of them are black.
white.
White. Most of them white. You will go again, Brother John. Get your hands wet and your
hands wet. Set it up.
Alright. I've heard people say that I treat people of my own race better than I do people of another race. How many guilty of that I've heard it said? That's one of my own. That's a brother. That's a brother. You know I'm going to help him out. That's a brother. You know, I'm going to help him out.
Like the dirty.
Yeah. We've gotten that, you know. So, how do you treat people? How do you treat strangers has a major impact on your loved one. Whoa, there we go. What did the word say? I thought I was in verse 6. Thou shalt not rest the judgment of thy poor in this house, and keep thee far from a false manner, and the innocent and righteous slay thou not, for I would not justify the wicked. I'm moving right along. And thou shalt take no gift, for the gift blinded the wise. This right here is fraud, persuasion,
bribery.
Verse 9. Thou shalt, that's what I'm getting to. Thou shalt not oppress a what?
Stranger.
That means somebody not like you. Another community. No, he's not from here. Who's that? I was going to give to that, but I found out they was all white, so I'm going over here to give to the urban league. So I give it to the, what's the big deal? Not Salvation Army. United Way.
I ain't giving to United Way. I'm going over here to the league. I know where the brothers are. That's where they need help. I like that.
For you know the heart of a stranger. You know the heart of a stranger. In other words, you know what they're going through because you was there yourself. You know that. You know you was poor. You know you was broke, hurt, down, out, and so forth. And here's a person that took yourself needing some help. And you're going to look at where they come from, who they are, and you're going to make your determination on that. Most folks have that opinion that I ain't giving to the, it's just me that still come on, feed the children. It's too big. They ain't throwing no money in there. I'm going down here to the church on the corner, what's happening that little halfway leading on the roof flying off church. So you know the heart of a stranger, seeing you were strangers were in the land of Egypt. You yourself have been there. You've been poor. Poor has no color, no class, no brackets to it. Hurting is hurting. Some folks will say, you know, brothers and sisters over here down there on Ghetto Street, north side of the east side. We ain't going over to the south side there for no folks out there. So they're all white. They got here. Hear it all the time. Mm-hmm. All the time. Now, the only qualifier is that all we at one time have what? Gone astray. And the deal is that all of us at one time did not have the love of God in our heart to administer. Once you have the love of God, the nature in your heart to administer and exemplify, demonstrate to the world, you should do it because God is, after all, no respect of what? You don't see that. But we would, politics, church, stuff, social life, neighborhood, you name it, we will make distinctions. Okay. I'll go for that. I got a charge. That's the first law of behavior. That's what we come out with. How do you behave?